Chapter 8, Part 2 of Dead Love Has Chains by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 8, Part 2. They were to dine at Hertford Street at 7:30, as it was an opera night, Don Giovanni, the old music they both adored, having that uneducated love of music which must be sustained with melody. Irene was in beauty again when they met the other two at the gate. "A pity you lost the race," said Mansfeld. "There was some fine riding, and Middlemore's horse won by half a length."
"Middlemore?"
"The owner of the favourite." "The man who was talking to me when you and Miss Thelliston joined us."
"Oh, is that his name? Irene knew him in Cashmere. At least, he was an acquaintance of her cousin's."
"Not a very desirable acquaintance, I should think. But if he's a friend of yours, I've nothing to say against him."
"I don't think there is anything to be said against him, except that he wasn't popular in his regiment. His father was a manufacturer somewhere in the north, and Middlemore had plenty of money when he was in the regiment, and I believe he spent it royally."
"But if his money is gone, how does he come by a racing stable?"
"Oh, his father is rich enough to keep him going. He's an only son, and he married an American girl, a millionaire's orphan daughter from Boston, very refined and nice, but not handsome."
"Was she with him today?"
"No, she crossed the Atlantic in her coffin last March, to lie in the family vault with her New England ancestors."
This was while they waited for the motor. There was not much more talk after they had taken their seats, and Conrad had his mind and his hands occupied in steering through the crowd of carriage people who hated motors, and motor people who hated other motors. No time for more than an occasional word to the two girls sitting behind him, muffled in their white cloaks and veils, no opportunity for any confidences till the Mercedes stopped before the white door in Chapel Street and Irene alighted.
"Only a quarter of an hour to dress," said Conrad, as he handed her out. "I shall send the motor back for you."
"Please don't trouble. I can have a cab."
"Too slow. My mother is a dragon of punctuality."
Irene was nearly as white as her chiffon frock when she appeared in Lady Mary's drawing-room, and again Conrad protested that it was his fault for having kept her on the lawn in the glaring sunshine. She had struggled against that deadly faintness during her hurried toilette, the maid doing everything that her own active hands usually did, and dressing her as if she had been a doll. She dared not look at herself in the glass. A great dread had come upon her since she had known that Henry Middlemore was free. She talked gaily enough to satisfy her lover while they were at dinner and afterwards at the opera when the curtain was down. Him she might deceive, but she saw Lady Mary watching her with an uneasy expression. She, who was in the secret of the past, no doubt divined that a worse trouble than a walk in the afternoon sun had blanched that perfect face. Happily there was no dance that Saturday night, nowhere to go after the opera, which was over early. Sir Michael and his wife were dining out, and had not come home when Lady Mary's landau brought Irene to her door, and her lover murmured his last fond words at parting. "No row to-morrow, but you would not be well enough to ride if it were a lawful day. I shall call early to ask about you, but you mustn't come down to breakfast or go and sit in a stifling church. If you have rested and are well enough for a stroll in Hamilton Gardens, at 1 o'clock I will get my aunt's key. You shan't be stared at and pointed at in the park.
Pray don't keep Lady Mary waiting."
She was glad when the door closed upon him. His tenderness could not comfort her. All around her was dark. She felt as if she had suddenly become blind and must grope her way among unknown obstacles. There was a letter lying on the hall table, a thick letter with a large staring scarlet seal, like a gout of blood, she thought. The servant picked it up and carried it to her on a salver as she went towards the staircase.
"A messenger brought it, ma'am, after 10 o'clock.
She had divined, without seeing the address, that it was for her. A carriage stopped at the door as she ran upstairs, and she heard her father's voice in the hall before she could get into her room. The dinner-party had been later than usual, and no one but the servants had seen the letter. She locked her door to keep out the French maid who was Lady Thelliston's servant, and who had very little respite from her assistants in those elaborate arts which maintain fictitious beauty. What scanty leisure she had was at Miss Thelliston's service, and she was called a joint maid. Irene switched on the light and flung herself into a chair by the open window to read her letter. She knew the hand too well, too well. How many surreptitious scraps of notes had been secretly delivered, in her book, in her fan, in the loop of a sash, in a bunch of tropical flowers. Dear, dear letters they had been to her in those foolish days, before the knowledge of evil. Letters telling her she had looked lovelier than ever at the ball last night, had danced divinely, in a word, that she was adorable. Oh, that delicious pink frock! You were like Venus in a rosy cloud. I think there is something of that sort in Virgil. Adorable, adorable, adorable! The scraps of bold, manly writing all sang the same song. All told her she was lovely and beloved, and all pleaded for more intimate moments, a walk in the compound in the moonlight, a tete-a-tete ride, some sweet solitude of two that was to be managed somehow, some evasion of her chaperon, some escape from the crowd. His brain was fertile in expedients. He was always telling her how to elude the people whose duty it was to take care of her, always teaching her how to deceive. Those little scraps of praise and love had been very dear, for it was thrilling to the inexperienced girl to know herself the central point of a strong man's thoughts, the absorbing interest of his life, to be told of sleepless nights spent in thinking of her, of days that were pain and grief because they had to be spent away from her. And now the same strong penmanship was a thing of horror, a thing that recalled the folly, the degradation of that miserable past. Every word in that long letter was like a drop of molten lead, for to her the letter might mean doom. My darling, I have spent a weary hour hunting for your address. The beautiful Miss Thelliston, that's what people call you. I had heard of the beautiful Miss Thelliston, but I had actually forgotten your surname, and it never occurred to me that this much admired she was my Haidee, my child-wife, the only girl I ever loved with the whole force and passion of my soul. Ah, dearest child, you cannot have forgotten the night when I lay at your feet, and would have gladly died there rather than take up the burden of life with another woman. But I had to take up my burden. The fragile creature to whom I had pledged myself would have died if I had forsaken her. Those who knew her best, the aunt who had brought her up, the cousin who was like a sister, had warned me that to her sensitive nature disillusion would be fatal. It was not her fortune that tempted me, for my expectations from my father made me careless of that. I had to choose between my divine girl and the woman older than me by a year, who believed in me and depended upon me for the happiness of her life. Irene would soon forget the romantic dream of an Indian summer, a fairy tale of the hills and rose gardens, but my Boston sweetheart would not forget. She had given me the deep love of a thoughtful, self-contained woman. I could not cheat her. She was a dear and devoted wife, and I think she was happy with me. She never knew that she was not the first and only woman who had ever held my heart. She died in my arms after a year of troubled health, during which I did everything that care and science could do to keep her alive. She left me rich and childless, free to begin life again, but with very little interest in anything except my racing stud, which had amused and pleased her, and in a rubber at bridge. Then in a moment your face flashed upon me, and I knew that life was worth living. I am free, dearest. I am a free man now. The times are changed since that day when I stood before your cousin feeling like a beaten hound, pretending that I had thought of you only as an enchanting child, the sweet companion of an idle day. You, you, the girl I adored, my Haidee, my bride. Well, it was hard lines for us both, but we have a long life of happiness waiting for us, a life that will make amends. You are still in the dawn of girlhood, very little older than in those wild days, and ever so much lovelier. I am not by any means an old fogey, and to have you for my own will make me young again. Dearest, let it be soon. Every day will seem an age till I have you in my arms, my own, till death. We can be married quietly, and just slip away to Italy on our way to India, and that romantic valley where we met. Think how delicious it would be to revisit the place where we were so happy, to wander once again in those enchanting scenes where we first knew the rapture of mutual love. For my own part, I think it will save all troublesome explanations if we keep everything dark till after we are safely married and have left England. You can meet me in the park some morning, and we can be married by special license at the least frequented church in your parish. But if, on the other hand,
You prefer to tell your father that you are going to marry me. Having known and liked me years ago as a chance acquaintance in Kashmir, he will naturally inquire about my means. In that case, you can tell him I can afford to make a liberal settlement, and that I feel sure I can satisfy him. My wife left me all her fortune, including her property in Yorkshire, an estate bought soon after our marriage, big farms and substantial homesteads, a fine park and a picturesque Jacobean house, which I know my Irene will love, as she will love the horses that have been my one extravagance of late years. But my bright bird shall never be caged in her country home an hour longer than she is supremely happy there. She shall have all the world to roam over at her own sweet will, with a husband whose delight will be to please her. Let me have a letter to-morrow morning by a messenger. This hotel is not half a mile from your house. Your devoted, Hal. Saturday night, the Carlton Hotel. This was his letter. This was the offer that he made in good faith, never for a moment doubting her acceptance. She belonged to him by that shameful past, that past of which he could write so lightly, having known only the sweetness of it. One bad half-hour with her chaperone, one passionate outbreak of remorse in the dead of the Indian night, just a few curses and groans and tears, and his price had been paid. He loved and he rode away. The light love was forgotten, perhaps, and had only revived at sight of her, a new fancy, selfish, impetuous as the old passion. And her year of ignominy and suffering, that unhappy time in which she hardly dared to lift her eyes before the few people who came to her aunt's house, the priest, the parson, the hunting squire and his wife and daughters. Her aunt's friends were not many, but she hated them all. Her pride grew fiercer in that secret humiliation. No one knew, no one was ever to know. Her aunt, Mrs. Fitzpatrick, was a resolute managing woman, but not unkind, not without compassion. The youth of the victim weighed with her. The father had thought chiefly or solely of the disgrace, the trouble, and inconvenience for himself. His sister could pity the girl whose innocence had been the cause of her fall. Irene's health had broken down soon after her arrival in Ireland, and she had been ill enough to be kept in seclusion, waited on and nursed by her aunt, till the hour of her new trial drew near, and then aunt and niece went unattended to an obscure seaside village in the west, more than 100 miles from Mrs. Fitzpatrick's home, and here, though the aunt gave her own name, the niece was described as Mrs. Brown, whose husband was soldiering in India. Mrs. Fitzpatrick's air of impeccable respectability, a certain authoritativeness that argued social status, left no room for question. The landlady was delighted to have such lodgers at the end of the season when her usual tenants were gone. Tonight, sitting with her hands clasped above her head, and Henry Middlemore's letter before her, Irene lived over that dreadful time. Imagination brought back the moaning of the Atlantic in the long sleepless nights, while she thought of what her life was to be as the mother of a nameless child. Love had died the death between the night of agonized farewell and these hours of weary waiting. And when her aunt, sitting by her bed in the deep of night, when she felt in her utter weakness as if she were drifting upon a sluggish river, drifting to darkness and ease, told her very gently that her child was dead, and that her secret and her shame had died with him, she had neither the sorrow of a woman with the maternal instinct, nor the thankfulness of a worldling. She thought and hoped that she too would soon be dead, and that she had come to the last link in the chain of misery. Had he not made her suffer, this man who wrote so glibly, and offered her the delight of revisiting the scenes fraught with such bitter memories? What of happiness had she ever known from the night they parted till she met Conrad Harling and knew the meaning of a good man's love? Her dearest, her truest, most generous, most chivalrous of men, in whose large heart no taint of self-love had ever entered. And was she to surrender that noble lover, to give herself to the man whose sensual passion had blighted her life, the unscrupulous seducer, who could not respect the innocence of a girl just escaped from a school where evil things were unknown, where every book and every lesson, every allusion to the outer world, was chosen with a studious reverence for youthful purity? This man must be answered. She knew how impatient, how persistent he could be, how in that brief time when she had begun to fear him, with some instinctive prescience of her danger, he had pursued every advantage, seized upon every opportunity of that unconventional life,
how he had hunted and waylaid her. He would have to be answered, and at once. She was long writing that answer, though her letter was brief. The church clock struck two before she had addressed and sealed it. "The past is past," she began. "It was more dreadful to me than you can ever know. I have only one favor to ask. Forget me, as I have tried to forget you. I am going to marry a man whom I dearly love, and I know that you are too honorable, and I hope you are too kind to come between me and that great happiness. Let the dead bury their dead. I have never reproached you. I have never breathed your name to anyone belonging to me. No one knows how cruel you were to a helpless girl. No one will ever know from my lips. Perhaps you think it would be a kind of reparation if you were to marry me. But believe me, there is only one reparation in your power, and that is to be a stranger to me for the rest of our lives." There was no signature. Her penmanship would be sufficient evidence against her should he be wicked enough to show her letter to anyone who knew her. But that was a depth of infamy of which she could not suppose him capable. Reparation! That was what his letter meant. Their marriage was to make everything happy. And that miserable past was to be thought of as a fairy tale of girlish love, a memory of days that had been sweet, to be dwelt upon in sentimental moments amidst the security of married life. This was the man she ought to marry, this man whose coarse mind could conceive no shame in the remembrance of sin. She was bound to him by that shameful past. He had the right to claim her. He was the only man upon earth to whom she could go as a bride without dishonor. She could realize this stern truth, and yet reject his offer, resolved to give herself only to the man she loved, her preux chevalier, her Phoebus Apollo, radiant in the glory of enchanting youth, frank, joyous, a creature made for happiness, made to be adored. She had discovered a likeness in Conrad's clear-cut Greek features to the Belvedere Apollo. He had the same outlook, his head had the same poise. And he loved her with a passion as pure as it was strong, loved her with a love that sees something of divinity in the chosen wife. It was 4 o'clock before she fell asleep, and then sleep was worse than waking, for Henry Middlemore's image was mixed with the trouble of her dreams. When the maid brought the morning tea, she sent her to Lady Thelliston to say that she had a bad headache and would not leave her room till after church time. She would get up at about 11 o'clock, she told the maid, and would want no help in dressing, after her clothes were put out, the white crepe frock, the pansy tuck, and so forth. If Mr. Harding called, he was to be told she would be in the drawing-room at 1:45, ready to go for a walk. And then she drank her tea, and lay down again, trying to compose herself, trying to bring the colour back to her pallid cheeks, the brightness to her haggard eyes. She badly wanted to sleep. She longed to sink into the gulf of oblivion, the darkness where memory and pain are not. That deep oblivion would not come at her bidding, only fitful snatches of slumber, with intervals of restlessness, fretful movements, rebellion against fate. Had she not suffered enough? Had she not a right to be happy after those quenching fires, that heavy price paid for sin? Duty, truth, honor. Those were mere words when weighed in the balance against happiness and love. She knew that, if she kept her secret, she could make Conrad happy. She knew that to tell him the story of her fall would be to make him miserable, perhaps to plunge him again into the darkness of that living death of the lunatic asylum, he whose exuberant nature was made for the glory of life, made to be happy and to diffuse gladness. Conrad's card was lying on the hall table when she went downstairs at 12 o'clock and crept out of the house to post her letter. A messenger was, of course, impossible. The man must wait till Monday morning for her answer. He would be angry, no doubt, surprised and indignant at her refusal, but she did not think he would try to injure her. There was a pillar-post a few doors off, and her absence had lasted less than 5 minutes. The footman looked surprised when he opened the door for her, no one having heard her go out. "Mr. Harding called at 9 o'clock to inquire for you, ma'am. Brixham gave him your message, and he said he would be here soon after 12. She had only been just in time with her letter. Conrad appeared before she had been in the drawing-room 5 minutes, enchanted to find her waiting for him, ready for their Sunday morning walk, full of solicitude about her health, needing to be assured that she had quite recovered from the headache that his folly had caused. they went to Hamilton Gardens, Conrad rejoicing in the little bit of solitude they might have before people came out of church, Irene's share of the conversation being performed very feebly. She had seen Henry Middlemore on the other side of the way as they crossed Hill Street, and she thought that he might be going to the house to make some inquiry about her, after being disappointed of a letter in the morning. Oh, the horror of it all! If he were going to dog her footsteps, to haunt her, to hunt her down! She had tried to believe it was impossible that he should persecute her, that he must have some generous feeling, some touch of remorse that would induce him to spare her, when once he realized that her love was dead, that another and a better love had come into its place. He knew nothing yet, and no doubt was acting upon the presumption that she still loved him and would forgive everything for love's sake. And then there was something else that he did not know. The slow fire of shame, the shame that had burnt into her heart and brain and had killed the love. She was glad when the gate closed behind them, and they were walking in the exclusive Eden, where the few could escape from the many. "I want to talk of something very serious," Conrad said, and seeing her sudden, scared look. "My dearest, don't be frightened. It isn't anything gloomy or horrid. I want you to fix our wedding day. We are always talking about it as coming soon, and I know your frocks are being made, but we have been vague so far. Let it be soon, love, very soon." They were alone in the shelter of the trees, and he could even venture to slip his arm through hers and draw her a little nearer to him, his ear on the alert for approaching footsteps. "When shall it be, love?"
"You must settle that with my stepmother. I am afraid she'll want to make a fuss and invite people, my father's friends, most of them soldiers. Let it be as soon as she likes. I want to belong to you, Conrad. I want to be sure that we are bound to each other for life."
He was enraptured at her speech, the most direct avowal of love he had ever had from her. "My sweet girl, you have filled my cup of bliss. I'll talk to Lady Thelliston after lunch. She can order the invitation cards tomorrow morning. They ought to be ready in 24 hours, and a fortnight's invitation will be enough.
Wedding invitations are generally much longer."
"That's only to give people time to buy presents. We don't want candlesticks or paper knives, do we?"
"What can I want? You have loaded me with lovely things."
"Nothing half lovely enough. The jewelers have no new ideas. They can only offer one something that they made last week for a duchess or a countess. They have no new departures. One must go to Italy for an idea."
They walked in the gardens till 1:30, no longer in blissful solitude, but meeting people they knew every 5 minutes. They were on the way back to Chapel Street when in the little street by Dorchester House they came into a group of people and stopped to talk, and while Conrad was monopolized by a loquacious dowager, Irene found Henry Middlemore at her side. She had not seen him coming, did not know where he had sprung from.
"I hope you haven't forgotten me, Miss Thelliston," he said, offering his hand, and then he went on in a much lower voice. "No letter. If you knew how I am devoured by impatience."
"I posted my answer an hour ago."
"Cruel! I shan't get it till tomorrow. An eternity."
People were talking all round her, yet she was in an agony lest Conrad should hear. She broke in upon the dowager's discourse.
"We shall be very late for luncheon," she said.
Middlemore lifted his hat and went away, but those few words, his persistence in talking to her when she was among people, had given her an agony of fear. The chattering group dispersed.
"There was no escape from that woman," Conrad said. "That was the man we met yesterday, wasn't it? The man whose horse won?"
"Yes."
"What a presuming cad to talk to you."
She did not answer him. She walked by his side in dull silence. Middlemore's persistence filled her with dread. He had waited for her while she was in the gardens, watched her and followed her when she came out. Despair came upon her suddenly as she realized her peril. A word, a look, from this man might awaken Conrad's suspicions. He would question her, drive her to distraction, force her to prevaricate and to lie. And doubt, once awakened, the fierce suspicion of jealous love, he would not rest till he had dragged her secret from her, would not be appeased till the veil was rent from that disgraceful story, and he knew her for the thing she was. And then to be thrown off and abandoned, to see the warm, fond lover turned into a man of stone, cruel to himself as to her, inflexible even in his despair.
She had learnt to know his way of thinking, all his opinions, prejudices, beliefs. And she knew that an unvirtuous woman was hateful in his eyes. She had watched his countenance when improper people had been discussed in his presence, lightly, with a smoothing over of hard facts, and she knew that in his mind there was no indulgence for sin. His chivalrous ideas about women were allied with a severity as of the 17th-century Puritans. She hardly knew how she lived through the rest of the day. She dined at home, and went with Lady Telliston to a rather prim evening party where she was to meet Conrad and his mother. She tried to avoid Lady Mary, feeling that those keen, clear eyes would read her trouble, might even divine the cause, and know that her first lover had come back into her life. She heard two men talking of him as the owner of yesterday's winner. "Not half a bad fellow, very popular in his own part of the country, an invalid wife, died at Cannes last winter. They want him to take the hounds next season, plenty of money." And then the conversation changed, and she heard no more of him. It was a dull party, though there were three or four well-known politicians and more than one artistic and literary celebrity in the little crowd. There was no music, and by a quarter past 11 everybody had gone on or had gone home. Conrad had hardly left Irene's side, and she had tried to talk lightly and to seem gay. He told her of his satisfactory conversation with her stepmother. The wedding invitations were to be ordered next morning and sent out on Wednesday, a 10 days invitation. "And now you have only to make up your mind about the honeymoon. Where shall we go? To what secluded nook in Switzerland, or on the Italian side of Mont Blanc, and then down into Italy, to Locarno, Pavino, Stresa? To be together and alone in that divine country! Think what bliss!" All this was spoken in confidential tones while they sat under an awning on the balcony in a thicket of palms. He was radiant with the assurance of happiness, expectant of a life without a cloud. He asked about the bridesmaids. Had she chosen them, and how many? Daisy, of course, must be one of them. "My stepmother insisted upon 6 bridesmaids, girls whose mothers were her bridesmaids. She knows crowds of people. I know she has asked your cousin, and Miss Meredith has kindly consented to be one of the 6. My father and I would have liked a quiet wedding, just one bridesmaid, but I suppose Lady Mary would think that kind of thing rather discreditable."
"Oh, I dare say she will approve of Lady Thelliston's plans. She will like a little fuss. But if I could marry you to-morrow morning in the quietest church in London, some dear old city church, St. Andrew's, Holborn, for instance, and whisk you off to Lucerne in the Engadine Express, I should think myself the most blessed of men."
She sat by his side in silence, with a heart of ice, remembering how that other man had pleaded for a quiet wedding, and a swift flight to fairer scenes, to that unutterably beautiful world, the valley girl round with snow mountains where they had met and loved and parted. She let her hand lie in Conrad's, and he bent down and kissed it in the shadow of the palms. The beautiful head, with the short, crisp brown hair, bent down to worship her, and while he worshipped, there was another man claiming her as if by an indefeasible right. She rode in the park with her father and Conrad next morning, rejoicing in her Arab's freshness and the gallop that brought the colour back to her cheeks. Between Stanhope Gate and the Row she had time to think what an escape it would be if she could bring about an accident, make her horse bolt with her and break his neck and hers over the railings. She remembered a favourite novel in which she had read of such a catastrophe, and how in the story sudden death had solved a problem, as it might solve the problem of her life. If she were killed that morning, Conrad would never know. His mother would not break her oath. Lady Mary would be content to know that he was released from the bond she hated, and death would cancel Henry Middlemore's claim. Conrad reproached her for riding wildly. "If you ride with such a loose rein, I shall be afraid to let you ride to hounds," he said. He had talked to her of the hunting next year, and that he might take the hounds perhaps by and by. They were to winter in Egypt, but there might be a chance of some good sport in March when they went home. Home! The word had been sweet in her ears. But now there was the blackness of impenetrable night round her, dread, and almost despair. End of chapter 8, part 2. Chapter 8, Part 3 of Dead Love Has No Chains by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 8, Part 3. There was a letter lying on the hall table when she went in, exactly like the last, a conspicuous letter with a big vermilion seal, delivered by hand.
"Who's your correspondent?" her father asked sharply, as she took up the letter.
"Oh, it's nothing of importance."
"Is it a bill?"
"No, only a circular."
She ran upstairs before he could ask any more questions, and shut herself in her room. Her frock was laid out on the bed, and Justine would be engaged with Lady Thelliston for the next 2 hours. She was safe in her seclusion till 11 o'clock, when Daisy was to call for her, and they were to go together to the people who were making her trousseau, and who had to be kept up to time. This was the letter she had to read, she who ardently desired to know herself bound to Conrad Harling through life until death. Within less than a fortnight of the day appointed for her wedding, she had to read this letter and consider all that it meant.
"Your letter just to hand is a thunderbolt. I suppose I had no right to expect that you would remain free, and indeed when we parted, when I left you with an aching heart to fulfil an engagement from which I saw no escape, I told myself that I hoped you would meet with someone better worthy of your love, that you would make a happy marriage, and that all we had been to each other would seem to you no more than the memory of a dream. Could I think otherwise in that dark day when I was leaving you, as I thought for ever, to keep faith with the woman to whom I had bound myself before I had ever seen your love-compelling face? But now that there is no barrier to our happiness, now that the one desire of my heart and mind is to call you wife, it seems to me impossible that any other man can stand between us. Remember what you have been to me, and ask yourself if you can refuse to be mine, now that Providence has put it in our power to cancel all that was unfortunate in the past by the most solemn, the most sacred of bonds. Can you for an instant contemplate giving yourself to another man while I am here to remind you of my claim, I who am the only man living who has any right over you? What power of choice can you have in such circumstances? Can I believe that you will call another man husband and deny yourself to me, whose overmastering passion brought shipwreck upon us both, when you were a child in ignorance of evil, a woman only in the power to love? Oh, my divine girl, think of those days. Think of all we were to each other, my Haiti, so lovely and so innocent. I was a wretch to hazard the sweet enchantment of those hours, a wretch not to fly temptation, not to leave you while you could still remember me without pain. But if I made you unhappy, then I give you a life of devotion in atonement for my sin. Do not try to cheat me. Do not imagine that I will forego my right to make you my wife without needless delay. In the face of your letter, I shall not rest till you are legally mine. I shall apply for the special license to-day, and shall leave this hotel and take rooms in your parish. Yours, and yours only, till death do us part. H.M. All the more determined phrases were heavily underscored. From the first words to the last, the letter was a menace. She remembered the tyranny of his love in the days when she had loved him. She was then at the age when a girl adores a tyrant. His determined pursuit of her had been the charm that worked to such fatal issues. To be pursued, to be worshipped, it was the schoolgirl's dream of bliss. But now, with this letter in her hand, remembering what he had been, a deadly fear took hold of her. He had been her master then, when she loved him. He was her master now, when she hated him. How could she have hoped that he would be generous, that he would stand out of her way and let her take her own road to happiness? How could she have hoped that pity or honour would seal his lips when he wanted to marry her? Self was his god and his law. She knew that now, recalling details remembered, though not understood in those foolish hours, before she had acquired wisdom in the school of misery. He would have no mercy. What could she do? She dared not defy him. She had told him that love was dead, and he had ignored that plea. He wanted her. He would make her his bond slave and would laugh at the power of a rival. He would make her marry him. There was the sickening dread that froze her. She saw herself at his mercy. If she persisted in refusing him, he would fight for her with the most odious weapons, would tell her lover all that the cruelest speech could tell ever sin-stained girlhood. She would stand before her preux chevalier, the man who worshipped her, a lost creature. She had told Lady Mary that Conrad would cleave to her even if he heard her story. The disillusion might go near to break his heart, but he would not forsake her.
He would take her, degraded, humiliated, changed utterly from the goddess he had worshipped, and would pardon and pity her. But love and life would be changed. And she told herself that she could not live under the burden of his pity. She could not live with him and be happy, conscious of the change in his feelings. Better anything than to be his wife, knowing that she had forfeited his respect, that he was sorry for her, and sorry for himself as her husband. What was she to do? She had no hour in the day that she could call her own, no power to go the length of Chapel Street without accounting for her moments. Her stepmother was too self-absorbed to be formidable, but she had an idea that her father suspected her, that those cold, cruel eyes followed and watched her. He had looked at her keenly when he questioned her about that dreadful letter, so obviously not a tradesman's circular. She was like a hunted stag at bay, the cry of the pack gaining on her. She had no time to think, no time to map out her course. An imperative message had come from her father before she had taken off her riding clothes. He was at breakfast and wanted to see her. It was her daily task to pour out his coffee and to pretend they were on excellent terms, a model father and daughter. He was a man who loved shams. At 11, Daisy came for her in Lady Mary's Victoria, and she was driven to Dover Street to spend a weary hour trying on garments of every description, her wedding dress, her clothes for Italy, and her clothes for Egypt. Conrad was pacing the street, waiting for them to come out and join him, and then they were to go and walk in the park by the sumptuous flower-beds, while the driving people and the riding people and the walking people went by them like figures in a cinematograph. To Irene, on that miserable day, nothing in the world seemed real except her own despair. A few yards from the Stanhope gate she saw Henry Middlemore standing with his back to the railings watching them. She looked straight before her, and went on talking to Daisy, pretending not to see him. "That man haunts us," Conrad said when they had passed. "What man?" "The owner of Horoscope. Didn't you see him?"
"No."
She managed to post a letter to Middlemore that afternoon, hiding it between other letters and dropping it into a pillar-box before Conrad's eyes as they walked through Esher, where the Mercedes had carried them to take tea in an inn garden, Daisy and Professor Wilmer for their companions, the professor attaching himself to Daisy in a dull, persistent way, like a learned barnacle. He was never weary of expounding his views about the universe for her edification, and he had told her incidentally that he would like to marry her. Conrad was to dine in Chapel Street and to meet his betrothed at two dances. Her letter to Middlemore was brief. "If you will walk in the park by the flower-beds between Stanhope and Grosvenor Gate tomorrow morning at 6:30, I will try to join you for a quarter of an hour. There is no use in any more letter-writing." That was all. No signature, no address. Such an appointment was a desperate thing, but she thought it would be safe at that early hour. No servant would come downstairs before 7, and she would only have to unbolt the street door and go out. Her father came down at 8 for his morning ride. She could be back at the house at 7:15, in time to put on her habit. The servants could do no more than wonder. They might think she had gone out for an early walk with her fiancé. The second and more delightful of the two dances did not begin to languish till after 3 o'clock, when Lady Thelliston declared herself absolutely worn out, a fact confirmed by the damaged state of her complexion, and insisted on carrying off her stepdaughter, in spite of Conrad's petition for one more extra. Irene had been paramount in beauty, crowned with the factitious interest of approaching nuptials, all other girls curious about her, and most of them inclined to depreciate her charms, and to consider Mr. Harding much too good for her. No doubt she was very pretty in a certain style of her own, rather like Lady Hamilton in Romney's pictures. And, well, everybody knew what kind of person his famous sitter was. Quite a Romney beauty. And she had dropped from the skies last June. She had no connections about the court. The king had asked who she was in a tone that implied a great deal. She had not even been presented on this side of the Irish Channel. She was going to be after her marriage. The father was a soldier, but no one had heard of him till that West African affair the other day. The mother, or stepmother, was too odious for words. In point of fact, they had no connections whatever that anybody knew of. They were quite new people, and they were living in a squeezy little house in Chapel Street, quite impossible for entertaining. In such phrases did the faded and partnerless express their poor opinion of Irene and her people. The sky was sunless and grey, and there was a chilliness in the air when Irene stole out of the house soon after 6 o'clock to keep her appointment with Middlemore. Her endeavour to sleep in the daylight and amidst the sound of awakening birds and early traffic had been vain. 2.5 hours of restlessness had made her more tired than when she left the dance, and she had that strange, vague feeling of not being more than half alive which comes from sleepless nights and the strain of hidden trouble. From Saturday afternoon till Tuesday morning her brain had been working at an 80 horsepower, not an hour's natural sleep, not a minute's respite from torturing thoughts in her waking hours, not even when she was waltzing with her lover in the flower-scented ballroom, gliding round in an elysium of music and light, his strong arm encircling her, his kind eyes watching her face with ineffable love. No, there had been no pause in the torment of the labouring brain. What was she to do? Was there any hope, any way of escape from the doom she loathed? To part from the man she loved, to give herself to the man she hated? Now, in the chill grey morning, past the awakening flowers, she was hurrying to meet the hated lover, to fight her last battle for freedom, and make her last appeal to the tyrant. The cool air revived her, and that dreamlike feeling of not being quite conscious of existence, which amounted almost to the loss of identity, left her in the freshness of the morning. It was not 6:15 when she went into the park, but Middlemore was there before her, a few yards from Grosvenor Gate. She saw the tall figure, broad and stalwart, coming towards her with a swinging step on the solitary path. There was no one else within sight. They had the park to themselves. He almost ran to meet her, and before she could speak he was holding her in his arms, and his kisses were on her face, the kisses of love that will not be denied. She gave a cry of despair and struggled to escape, but the strong arms held her close. She felt like some wild thing that had fallen into a trap. "My angel, how sweet of you to come," he said, with his lips on her face. She went on struggling impotently. Her cheeks that had been white when she met him were flaming with angry fire. "Let me go," she gasped. "You don't know how I hate you." "No, no, if you hated me you would not have come. No, no, it is love that brings my Haiti to my arms." He saw people coming, a sauntering policeman, a groom exercising a horse, and released her from that fierce embrace, and slipped his arm through hers, and led her across the road to the turf under the trees where they might walk unseen. She was trembling violently, and the weakness of strained nerves made her helpless. "Let me sit down, or I shall faint," she said, and he took her to a bench and seated her by his side with his arm round her. He took off her hat and made her rest her head against his shoulder, and held her as a man holds a woman who is his own. There was a rough tenderness in all he did, a tenderness that had been enchanting in the old days, when the glamour of unknown love held her spellbound and at his mercy. "I came to tell you that I mean to marry Conrad Harling," she said, when she could command her voice. "Not while I live, not while I live. You are my wife in the sight of God. You must wait till you are my widow if you want to marry any other man." "No, I am not your wife. I owe you nothing. You have not the shadow of a right over me. You left me to my misery, to my shame." She burst into tears and hid her face in her hands, sobbing violently. The loosely rolled up hair fell over her neck and shoulders. Middlemore sat for a minute in deep thought. Then, with extreme tenderness, with hands that caressed the lovely tresses, he bound them into a knot and gathered up the scattered combs and made her head look neat again. "You spoke of shame," he said in a low voice. "What shame could there be, except in my sweet girl's tender conscience?" "There was shame, bitter shame, a year of shame. It was a year after you forsook me, before I could go into the light of day without shrinking from every eye, hating my fellow creatures, a year before I left my sick bed, a wreck. Ah, if you had seen me then, you would not have wanted me. Such a wasted, sickly creature would have no attraction for you." He hardly heard what she said. He took her to his breast again with irresistible force. "My beloved girl, I never dreamt. I never for a moment contemplated. Oh, what a brute I was!
But you told me nothing. You never hinted at your trouble. How could I think that you would have kept such a secret? Our child? Oh, how I shall adore, how I shall worship my Hades child, son or daughter! How divine a gift! Where have you hidden our child?
In the grave, she answered. He did not live through the day.
My angel, my suffering angel! But we have life before us, and we are going to be happy. And could you think of marrying another man, you, the mother of my son? It was a shameful thought.
There was a change in his accent as he spoke those words, a change to absolute severity. It was a shameful thought. That was this man's opinion. And how about the other man whom she adored, her preux chevalier? If she could defy Middlemore and marry Conrad Harding, might not the day come when he would tell her that it was a shameful thought, a shameful act that had given her to his arms? Would love excuse her? Would beauty win his pardon, beauty disfigured by sin? No, she could not marry Conrad. She could not face the possibility of his anger, his grief, his killing contempt. Perhaps she had known from the moment when Henry Middlemore took her in his arms that the battle was lost. She had come into the cool gray morning, braced with angry resolution, prepared to fight a desperate battle, determined to win. But he had given her no chance of fighting. She was his prey. He had taken possession of her. He had held it unquestionable that she must be his. The old tyranny subjugated her. Something there might be, perhaps, of the old magnetism, when the lightest touch of that strong hand, trembling as it stirred the lilies upon her breast, had thrilled her with girlhood's unquestioning love. She knew that the battle was lost. After her passion of sobs, she sat looking straight before her, with tearless eyes, conquered, despairing. "I suppose you would be sorry if I were to kill myself," she said at last in a low, toneless voice.
"No, no, you will not kill yourself. You bore that year of martyrdom, my poor dove. Why should you want to die now when you have a happy life before you? You think you are in love with this harling fellow, but that's skittles. He is younger than I am, altogether more attractive, I dare say. But I am the man you loved when first your heart knew what love meant. I am the man you will love till your dying day."
She made no fight. She sat mute and defeated, and let him dictate to her.
"We can be married at 9 o'clock to-morrow morning. You have only to slip out of your house at 8:30. I shall be in the street watching for you. Don't trouble about bag or baggage. I will get all you can want for a few weeks, and after that, no doubt, your people will send your things. They may make a fuss at first, but when they find you have married a man of good means, they'll come round like a shot."
A clock struck 7. "I must go home," she said, putting on her hat. She did not look at him or answer him. She neither assented nor refused. She made no protest except for a long, agonized sigh. She was beaten. He walked with her till they were within sight of the flowery balconies, holding her arm all the way. She felt his love sustaining her, dominating her as in the past. She knew that it was real love of its kind, violent, tyrannical, exacting, but real. She knew that he was ready to fight for her, to do wild and desperate things rather than let her go. A housemaid opened the door and stared at her in blank surprise. "I have been walking in the park to cure my headache," she explained. "Tell Clarkson to let the groom know that my horse won't be wanted, and he can tell Sir Michael that I am not going to ride this morning." She flung herself upon the bed, beaten, beaten. She felt as if the beating had been not only moral but physical. Heart and limbs were aching. She wanted to lie upon the ground, face downwards, and never get up again. Middlemore had trodden her into the dust. She did not leave her room that day. She refused to see Conrad. She sent him a line in pencil to tell him she was tired to death after the ball and must take a day's rest. He rushed off to an eminent nerve doctor who lived within a stone's throw, and gave himself no peace till that authority had seen the beloved patient and could assure him that there was nothing seriously amiss, only nervous prostration requiring seclusion and repose. An affair of a day or two. That was all. but for Conrad the world was empty. He hardly knew how to get through the day. His only relief was in talking to Daisy about the wedding, asking trivial questions about the frocks, about the bridesmaids, about the bride's luggage. "Shall we go and look at her trunks?" he asked, as if proposing a treat, and he straightway carried the submissive Daisy to the trunk-maker's, where he gloated over the great dress-box, the hat-boxes and bags, the cabin-trunk for the voyage to Alexandria. They were to be finished off in a hurry, with her initials I.H., and a four-leaved shamrock by way of badges on sides and lid. "Lady Thelliston is to find her a good maid," said Conrad. "The poor darling has had only a half-share in her stepmother's slavey up to now."
"Judging by Lady Thelliston's complexion, it would be more like a 16th," said Daisy.
Conrad rode with the general next morning. Irene was under the doctor's orders to keep her room.
"She has been doing too much," Sir Michael said. "Girls are simply insatiable. My poor wife is worn out. I heard them come in on Monday night, I should say Tuesday morning, a few minutes to four."
Conrad talked of Irene all the time. Would Sir Michael send her Arab to Cranford, where the stud groom would take particular care of him, in a loose box with his shoes off, till the spring, when they came home from Egypt? She should have her Arabs there, and revel in the desert rides, the delicious mornings, the charm and wonder of that land of strange gods. "Curious to think how we humdrum English have taken possession of it after all these centuries," he said, "and how we carry all our paltry modern luxuries, our fine clothes and snobism, to the land that was old when Herodotus wrote about it." He breakfasted with his mother and Daisy. He was restless and yet dull, as if that severance of 24 hours had been too much for his nerves. Lady Mary watched him anxiously. She felt as if there were thunder in the air. She had noted the change in Irene's manner on Sunday. And now the girl's nervous breakdown puzzled her, while the hurrying on of the wedding was a blow. It killed the remnant of hope, that slowly dwindling hope she had cherished from the beginning of Conrad's engagement, the hope that something would happen and that her son would be saved from that unholy union. She had submitted to the inevitable. She had been tolerant, and had put on a show of kindness to her intercourse with Irene. But the memory of that night on board the Electra, the shock of the girl's confession, had never been out of her mind since the hour she knew this girl was to be her son's wife. Conrad had called in Chapel Street before breakfast, carrying a tribute of hothouse flowers for Irene, with an 8-page letter written after midnight. He told his mother of this visit while they were at breakfast. "She won't leave her room till the doctor has seen her," he said. "But I know she'd like to see you, Daisy, if you will go and look her up."
"And you want me to tell you how she looks and what she says? If she is quite a wreck after being a day under the weather, if she has cried herself blind at being parted from you," Daisy said, laughing at him, full of kindness, resigned to the certainty that he was to pass out of her life altogether in a few days.
"Tell her I shall call before lunch to hear what the doctor has said, and if I may take her into the country in the afternoon. We might go to Brighton and give her a breath of sea air, and be back by 9 o'clock for dinner."
He went off to his den at the back of the house, carrying the Times with him, and totally incapable of reading it.
They had sat at breakfast longer than usual, and it was 10 o'clock when Lady Mary went to her morning-room.
"You can go to Chapel Street before you come for my letters," she told Daisy. "There is nothing very important this morning."
Whereupon Daisy went off meekly to put on her hat and to go and worship at the shrine of the strange goddess. She passed the Thelliston's footman on the way, walking towards Hertford Street, and the butler who opened the door had a certain discomposure in his looks. Miss Thelliston was not at home.
"Then she is better, I hope," said Daisy, "if she has really gone out."
"Yes," the man assured her. Miss Thelliston had gone out early, a few minutes after Sir Michael started for his ride. Daisy retraced her steps, wondering greatly. Conrad came out of his den and met her in the hall.
"Back already? They would not let you see her?"
he asked excitedly.
"She was not at home."
"Not at home? Nonsense."
"The butler said so."
He snatched up his hat and hurried out of the house. A letter had been taken to Lady Mary 5 minutes before, a letter carried by the footman Daisy had met on her way to Chapel Street.
"Tuesday night. You have won, Lady Mary. I am beaten in my battle for life and love, but not by you. Fate has been too cruel. The man you know of has come back to me, free to make me his wife, and he has compelled me to marry him. There is no help for me. I have fought hard, but he has conquered me. We are to be married early to-morrow morning. We are to leave England to-morrow night. I go to him with a broken heart. I can never love him, never respect him, never hope for happiness with him, remembering what Conrad has been to me, my noble lover, my king of men. Ah, you can never know how I have loved your son, or how happy I could have made him, with an adoring wife's devotion, obedience, unchanging fidelity, if fate had let me. I have had to succumb. If I were to persist in refusing Henry Middlemore, some dreadful thing would happen. It is best that I should be the sacrifice. I deserve nothing better. I thought that he had gone out of my life forever, that he was no more to me than the memory of a bad dream. But I met him at Sandown on Saturday, and from that hour I have had no peace. You tried to shame me into giving up your son, and you failed. Henry Middlemore has shamed me into marrying him, and your son has escaped. Will you break this news to him, and be merciful to me, and keep the secret which you swore never to betray on your crucifix? I do not think you could ever look upon that sacred image without dread if you were to break that oath. Never let him know of that dark stain upon my life. Never let him know that he has been twice the dupe of a pretty face. But indeed, I hope at my worst I am better than the innkeeper's daughter, for at least I have loved him fondly and disinterestedly, and I would have married him had he been a beggar, and would have been proud to call him husband. Have pity upon me now, Lady Mary, as you had that night on the Electra, for I am in as deep a pit of shame and sorrow. Irene Thelliston. Lady Mary sat staring into vacancy with the girl's open letter on the table before her. He had escaped. The union she had dreaded and loathed, the union of honour with dishonour, was not to be. He had escaped this danger. But could she dare to be glad, while that other and even worse peril threatened him? The peril of a mind overthrown by a sudden overwhelming grief. She knew how he loved this girl. She had seen the self-surrender, the total absorption of his whole being in that young love. She knew that from the night of the ball, from the hour when he had held the lovely girl in his arms, from their first waltz, from their first interchange of trivial talk, sitting among the palms and flowers in the half-light of a winter garden, he had existed only to adore her. Irene had become his world, and there was nothing else worth living for. Restless, silent, preoccupied in her absence, he woke to radiant life when she appeared. The light stereotyped amusements of each day had become Elysian joys. Only to be with her had made the dull earth fairyland. And now he was to be told that his goddess had been stolen from him, that the creature who was so soon to have been his own for life, had been taken from him for ever. Would it mend matters to tell him that she was worthless, that to marry her would have been a calamity? No. The revelation would only give a sharper edge to his grief, the agony of knowing that he had been fooled for the second time in his life. He burst into the room while Lady Mary sat looking at the treetops and the blue summer sky with unseeing eyes. "Mother, a letter has been brought to you, Irene's letter. What does it mean? She is gone. No one knows where. It's maddening. Give me her letter." He would have snatched the open letter from under his mother's hand, but she spread her hand over it, holding it on the table. "No, no, you are not to read her letter." A despatch-box stood open on the table in front of her. She threw the letter into it and put down the lid, which fastened with a spring lock. Then, turning to her son, she put her arms round his neck and drew his face down against her own. "My dearest son, be brave. Try to bear the heaviest blow you have ever had. If you could know how I love you, how my life is bound up in you, I think you would be brave for my sake. Where has she gone? Why? Why?" He was white to the lips, and his voice was hoarse and dull. And then, to his mother's horror, he burst suddenly into a laugh. "She was like the publican's daughter, I suppose. There is someone she liked better, some great coarse brute who knew how to master her." He remembered the man at Sandown, the man who had talked to Irene at the corner of Stanhope Street on Sunday, the man he had seen leaning against the park rails on Monday morning. "She has gone off with that fellow. That's what's the matter. Can't you speak?" he cried furiously.
She was married early this morning to Mr. Middlemore. It is not a happy marriage, Conrad. You have more reason to pity her than to blame her.
Pity her? Yes, I must pity her. Pity her for breaking my heart, for making me hate the world I live in, and all humankind, except you. I'll make that one exception, mother, though you did me the biggest wrong you could do when you brought me into this vile world, this world of lovely faces and black hearts. Black, black as Erebus. Oh, how I loved her! How I trusted in her love! And she was to make me happy. That was the burden of her song. I mean to make you happy. And she let me fix our wedding day, last Sunday. She melted into my arms, and sighed and said it could not be too soon. At that moment she was as utterly mine as wedded wife ever was. Mine by the beating of her heart, by the lips that trembled as I kissed them. And she has married that coarse brute, a creature of thews and sinews, a face flushed with high living. Do you say that they are married, now as we stand here? They were married early this morning, and they are to leave England to-night. Conrad, my idolized son, only tell me that you will show yourself a strong man, strong in moral force. You mean that I will grin and bear it, take my licking a little better than I did before? Don't be frightened, mother. I am not going back to Roehampton. She has killed the gladness of my life, but I won't let her kill mind and memory, if I can help it. I won't bring trouble upon you again, if I can help it.
He went out of the room after these words, and Lady Mary did not follow him. She must let him fight his own battle. He had taken the blow a little better than she had hoped, but his ghastly pallor and the strained look in his eyes had appalled her. The warning of the doctors was ever present in her mind. Don't let him be disappointed a second time. The disappointment had come, by no act of hers, and he had to bear the blow and live through the agony of it as best he could. She knew that she could do nothing to help him. The maternal heart might ache for him, but a mother's affection could not heal the wounds a fatal love had made. All attempts at consolation would be but a repetition of phrases that would fall upon the sensitive brain like the measured water-drops in the torture-chamber. End of chapter 8. Chapter 9 and the Epilogue of Dead Love Has Chains by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 9. Conrad went straight to Chapel Street, where he found Sir Michael Thelliston in the den behind the dining-room, a place where he kept his boots and the scanty literature of the establishment.
"Oh, my dear Harling, I was just going to Hertford Street. My dear, dear fellow!"
"I suppose you know why she has done this thing?"
"My dear fellow, I know no more, hardly anything more, than you do yourself."
"Oh, but you must. She must have been in love with this man. She would not jilt me a fortnight before our wedding day if there were not some kind of tie between her and this man. She must have been in love with him when they met in Kashmir, and then they lost sight of each other, I suppose. And last Saturday he came back into her life and whistled, as he would have whistled for his dog, and she went after him. She may have cared for him, perhaps, in Kashmir. I was not there with her. My niece told me that Irene was greatly admired. She was not 18, just out of the schoolroom. But my niece said she was turning heads, and this Middlemore was among her admirers.
Is that all you can tell me?"
"Yes, that's about all."
"And her stepmother, does she know no more than this?"
"She knows nothing. She is horribly upset, as I am. I was proud of my girl's engagement to you, proud of such a son-in-law. It is a diabolical stroke of fate. I know nothing of this man. He may be the biggest brute in England."
"Did she write to you?"
"Only a line to say that she was to be married this morning at 9 o'clock at St. Nectern's to Henry Middlemore."
"The letter was brought by a messenger after 10 o'clock. I went round to the church, but the doors were shut."
"Well, she has made her choice. I thought she loved me, but it seems I am easily deceived. God knows I loved her. Good-bye, Sir Michael. You have always been kind to me, but you can understand that I shan't care to see anyone belonging to her."
"No, no, I can easily understand. You have been cruelly wronged. I am ashamed of her.
I am deeply distressed. There is a box in her room that is to be sent to you. She has packed all your splendid presents in it.
Damn the presents! Do you think I want to see those again?
But they must be restored to you. That is unavoidable.
The general went with him to the hall door and wrung his hand at parting, and then went sighing back to his den.
Fool, fool, he muttered. 30,000 a year, and a man who was her slave.
He had found Middlemore's name in the Red Book. Henry Middlemore, late Grenadier Guards, D.L., J.P., of Danewood Park, York, Clubs, Reform, Turf. Conrad went to St. Nectern's and unearthed the verger to let him see the marriage register. There was the latest entry, the commonplace statement of a commonplace fact. Henry Middlemore, widower, Irene Thelliston, spinster. The witnesses were John Jobling, verger, and Sarah Blake, pew-opener. He went to his club, and he sat in the reading-room all day, behind a newspaper, pretending to read. Anything was better than to go back to Hertford Street, where his mother and Daisy would be watching him, and pitying him, and thinking about him all day long. He telegraphed to Lady Mary from the club early in the afternoon. "Dining at Arthur's, maybe late. Don't sit up for me." And having done this, he curled himself up in a big armchair in an obscure corner and pretended to sleep. Men went in and out without noticing him. He did not even attempt to dine. But he had some tea at 7 o'clock, and then walked to the station at Charing Cross to see the last of the girl he was to have married. If she was to leave England tonight, it would be by that train, he thought. He took a ticket for Dover, for the privilege of being on the platform when the train started, and stood amidst the confusion of anxious passengers and harried porters, waiting for the last look, that look which he swore to himself should be the last. There was the usual crowd for the boat-train, and the faces that passed him all seemed to wear the same expression, hurried, eager, and yet with a certain look of pleased anticipation, as if there were something revivifying in the mere fact of leaving one's country. It was always the same look, till he saw her face, and that was different. Her husband was walking close beside her, holding her arm, hurrying her footsteps, talking to her, flushed, eager, exultant, like a man who has just won some great stake, and who can scarcely contain himself for joy. She was dressed in black, an alpaca skirt and coat, a black tuck, rather shabby clothes that she had worn in Ireland. Conrad had never before seen her in black, and the change was startling. She was very pale, and she looked years older. Her face was drawn with mental pain, and her eyes looked straight before her. Conrad had never seen despair in a face till tonight. He took a step forward unconsciously, with outstretched arms, as if to snatch her from her doom. The sudden movement was unseen in the crowd. A porter opened the door of a compartment labelled Engaged, and Middlemore lifted his bride into the carriage. A servant came to the door and handed in travelling bag, rug, and sticks, and then went to the porter to see the luggage bestowed. "These two boxes for Dover, those three for Paris." Conrad saw the new boxes, small and neat, which had evidently been bought for the bride. The bride! She who was to have been his bride! Who was to have journeyed with him over that joyous route, over the dancing sea, to lands that were lovely and strange. He saw the pale, grief-stricken face till the last moment, till the train moved, and she was gone. Why had she done this thing? What motive could there have been for such a cruel treason if its only issue was despair? By what spell had this man held her? The mystery of it all was maddening. He left the station and walked through the streets like a man in a dream, till he found himself somehow in St. James Park. It was dark by that time, the thin darkness of summer, and the stars were shining. He walked slowly, lost in thought, in despairing wonder. Why had she done this thing? The face he had seen was not the face of a bride, but the face of a victim. So might Jephthah's daughter have looked, wantonly sacrificed to a father's irrational vow. He walked by the Green Park to Hyde Park, and across the sunburnt grass to Kensington Gardens. It was nearly 10 o'clock when he found himself at the northwestern extremity of the gardens, facing the railings and watching the traffic in the Bayswater Road, watching with eyes that saw passing wagons and omnibuses, carts and carriages, as strange things, meaningless, a procession of phantoms.
He took hold of the railings with his bare hands, clutching the iron bars with strained fingers, as if to bring himself back to conscious life by that painful contact of sharp-edged iron against sensitive flesh. Since he had left the railway station, he had been walking in a semi-conscious state, as he had walked on that long journey from Abingdon to Pasto. Along what dusty roads, up hill and down hill, across what bleak commons or rolling moorland, he had never known. The same loss of conscious identity had come upon him, or if not the same, something that came too near that perilous state. Memory was shaken. He had lost count of time. Where had he been? What had he been doing since he heard of Irene's marriage? Was it by days, weeks, or months that the interval had to be measured? "This means Roehampton," he said to himself, frowning. "No, I will not go mad. Once is enough. Once for one false woman, for one lovely, wicked face, the face that lures to madness or to death." He set himself to count the passing vehicles, standing there for a long time, staring into the road and watching now an omnibus, now a cab, a smart tradesman's cart, a brougham with flashing lamps, and then the rush of a motor, with great flaring eyes like an angry dragon. He looked at them and studied them deliberately and named them to himself. "No, I won't go mad." He turned on his heel and walked back to Park Lane. A woman spoke to him in the shadow of the trees. "Oh, you poor wretch!" he cried, giving her a handful of gold. "You never used any man as badly as I have been used," and passed on with quickened pace, so that she could only stand gazing at his receding figure, murmuring thanks that he could not hear. His mother came out of her room as he went upstairs. "What, you sat up for me after all?" he exclaimed. "In spite of my wire. I could not rest till I knew you were at home." "My best of mothers, don't worry yourself. I am going to take this business quietly. I am used to it, you see." He kissed her and went up to his own room. His quiet voice and manner gave her some slight comfort, but she lay awake all night with an aching heart, wondering what tomorrow would bring of grief or terror. Mother and son breakfasted tête-à-tête, Daisy having pretended a headache as an excuse for keeping out of their way. Conrad was perfectly calm, with the settled calmness of a man who is resolved to bear his burden and who is strong enough to bear it. "My dear mother, you must not be anxious about me," he said, looking up and surprising Lady Mary's watchful eyes, full of sad solicitude. "I have come to grief for the second time in my life, which seems hard lines considering that I am not 30. But I am not going to knock under. Indeed, far from knocking under, I am going to make capital out of my misfortune. Those African travels of mine, the Zambezi, Tanganyika, Nyassa, I am going to make that fairy tale a true story." "You want to go to Africa?" "Isn't it better than going back to Roehampton?" "Oh, my dearest," she cried, bursting into tears. He comforted her with sweet words and even put on an air of gaiety. "Why, my dear mother, a couple of years knocking about in Central Africa is no more nowadays than the grand tour was when Lord Chesterfield wrote those wonderful letters of his in the old house hard by." Lady Mary was fain to listen as he reasoned with her, arguing that a blow such as he had suffered was not to be got over by walking about the West End of London, or even mooning on the Italian lakes, or hunting in Hampshire. He had to do something that would call upon his thews and sinews and give his brain a holiday. "I won't go alone, ma'am, if it would fret you. I know a splendid fellow who would go with me, and who knows the country. I shall have to be pretty artful to prevent his finding out that I don't know it." He went off directly after breakfast to find his friend, and he set about his preparations for the journey with red-hot haste. He contrived to be occupied every day and almost every hour, till that sultry afternoon when he stood with his mother and Daisy Meredith in Southampton Docks bidding them good-bye before he and his comrade went on board the African steamer. And then the woman who loved him had to go back to the desolate house in the land of conventionalities, where one day and one year are painfully like every other day and year, and to harden their hearts against the pain of years in which they were not to see him. Years of peril for him, years of constant anxiety for them. It had to be borne. Africa was better than Roehampton. Perils from wild beasts, from climate, from famine, were better than a mind extinguished, a death in life. End of chapter 9. Epilogue. Conrad kept his word to his mother, and in the second autumn after the parting at Southampton he was settled at Cranford, and Daisy Meredith had her first ride after a pack that belonged to her cousin, and in every individual whereof she could take a personal interest. His African wanderings had been marred by few misfortunes: a bout of fever, a campfire that consumed the traveller's stores and left them in some danger of starvation, had been the worst incidents in travels that had extended from the Zambezi to the Congo. He came back to England in vigorous health, and he bore no outward signs of the disappointment that had changed the current of his life. He took kindly to the humdrum existence of the country squire, and rode hard, but not recklessly. He invited his friends to shoot with him over woods that had been carefully preserved during his absence, and he was active and cheerful, if not particularly joyous. The freshness of youth and delight in trivial things had gone from him forever. He read more, and thought more, spending solitary hours in his library. He interested himself in politics. He was a kind and energetic landlord, and built cottages that were ideal in healthfulness and comfort, aided in all his plans by Daisy's knowledge of peasant life, its needs and idiosyncrasies. He looked, and seemed in manner and ideas, 10 years older than in the brief summer of Irene's influence. When his mother tried to arouse his ambition, and wanted him to offer himself for his division of the county, he smiled, and begged her to be patient. "I was 7 years at Roehampton," he said, and she understood the cryptic reply. It would take him long to forget. The cure had only begun in Africa. They would have to be patient and bide their time. Daisy was his right hand in most things on the estate, on the home farm, in the stables and kennels. She had all the instincts of a country-bred girl, though she had languished in a London suburb till her 18th year. A daring rider, a fervid lover of the animal creation, ardent in the chase but always sorry for the fox, she was never more charming than at Cranford. And that knack of being never in the way and never out of the way was itself a charm. Lady Mary watched and wondered. Daisy was 28, but quite as pretty at that mature age as she had been at 18, prettier, perhaps, by the light of a developed intelligence that gave variety and sparkle to the face. She was not a Romney beauty, or a Raphael beauty, nor had she the sensuous lips and the dreaming violet eyes of a Rossetti beauty, but she was pretty enough to be the sunshine of a good man's home, the smiling welcomer at the end of a day's toil, the sympathizing wife in trouble and in joy. And she had bright and gracious manners that would ensure her popularity as the wife of a public man. Lady Mary thought that, however long the courtship might hang fire, her son would end by discovering that Daisy was something more to him than the adopted sister, the useful friend, the good pal, he affected now to consider her. And as Daisy's father had been obliging enough to die while Conrad was in Africa, there was one obstacle the less to the marriage from a social point of view. Of course, Daisy's mother was a difficulty. But that poor lady, having failed as a singing mistress, as a milliner, as a typewriter, as a crystal gazer, and as a manicurist, would be amenable to reason and could be pensioned and relegated to a modest villa at Hastings or Ryde. Conrad never uttered the name of his lost love after his return from Africa. But he could not hope to go through life without hearing of her, since Mr. Middlemore had crowned himself with glory by winning the Derby with Yorkshire Tyke, a horse of his own breeding. After an Indian honeymoon, he had settled down in Yorkshire with his beautiful wife, who shone as a star in a society made up of landowners in the neighbourhood, soldiers from York, and the men who came from afar for the big shoots. People talked of her as lovely, but with cold and unattractive manners. As a personality, the jovial Middlemore was preferred to his beautiful wife. They came to London for a short time in the season, but had no London house. They stayed at one of the smart hotels, and spent the greater part of their time at suburban race meetings and fashionable cricket or polo matches. End of epilogue. The End of Dead Love Has Chains by Mary Elizabeth Braddon. Recorded by Celine Major.